Good evening, cherished viewers. You're welcome to Kingdom Life Channel. We are here to present to your table one of the exclusive about the examples of Christ, the legacies of Christ, the legacies of our lives. We are here to substantiate an issue that will help broaden and then develop your Christian growth. Good evening. I'm your host, Humphrey, and I am here with Elder Andrew to help me discuss and you discuss this important and indispensable issue. Stay glued and then stay tuned also as we bring to your table this wonderful message. As we welcome Elder Andrew to have this discussion.
God bless you, man of God.
Elder, God bless you too. Hello. Good evening.
Good evening.
You're welcome to Kingdom Life Channel.
Amen.
This platform is one of the platforms that we propagate and extend the messages of Christ to the entire world. Our mission and our vision is to spread the word of God to those who do not have. Amen. You are warmly welcome to the show.
Thank you. God bless you for inviting me.
You're welcome. Last week, we dealt with, for the past a month ago and two, we've been dealing with issues of the Garden of Eden, sin, death, and the likes. And last week, you took us through one of the mystery about whether or not Adam ate fruit, and you gave a resounding demonstrations and explanations on that. But today, I want us to look at a section of an interesting topic that will serve my viewers, and then will do them very good as Christians. It will base on the examples of Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. But before we tackle that example of Christ or legacies of Christ, I want us to deal more about our life background, where we started our life from, and then we relate it to why we are supposed to live a life that will please Jesus Christ. So now, the question is, how was your life before you accepted Christ?
Let me take this opportunity to greet all your viewers around the world. Most of you might maybe call me a controversial person after this point. Because someone phoned me the other day and said that he has been to church for years. No pastor has been able to identify this fact that Adam and Eve did not eat any fruit. Yeah. So he told me I'm becoming radical and controversial. But all the same, to the glory of God.
The glory of God, that's true.
I greet all viewers around the world. And I encourage you all to keep looking to this Kingdom Life channel that will transform your life. Amen.
Amen.
Elder, as to how my life was before I met Christ, I would say from all my life as a child, I didn't know anything we call the world or gods or traditional gods or those things. From my childhood, my mother presented me to church. And I grew up in church. Every day she goes, I go. Where she sleeps, she slept, I slept. Yeah. But when I became to adolescent age, 21, 22, when you are that age, you think the world is yours. You want to explore the world to the level that you want to know more for yourself. So even though I went to church, because now I know the difference between a Christian and a church goer.
Yeah.
Yeah, I went to church, all right. I participated in the things that church people do. I did. But in my free time, I had fun. If I say I had fun.
So, not to cut you, what is the disparity between a Christian and a churchgoer?
Okay.
Before we proceed on.
Okay. A Christian is the one who Christ's spirit lives in him. Mm-hmm. He's not living a life on his own. He understands the fact that he was purchased from a slavery market of sin, owned by Satan. And if you read Colossians chapter 1, verse 13, he said he has translated us from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of his dear son.
Yep.
Such people have Christ's spirit inside of them.
Yep. Yep.
And they are maneuvered or steered by that spirit. Those are Christians. But those churchgoers, yeah, everybody's going to church. If I stay home, they will think I'm a witch, so let me go.
Yeah.
I need a husband, let me go to church and pray. I need a work, let me go to church and pray. They come to the church with a specific reason. They use Jesus as a means to an end. But Jesus is not a means to an end. Mm. Jesus is the end. So Christians know that he is the end. Sometimes they sing this song. He came from heaven to earth,
yeah,
to show the way. To show which way?
Mm-hmm.
Church goers sing that song. He came from heaven to earth to show the way.
Mm-hmm.
But he said, I am the way. See the difference now?
Yeah.
So true Christians, Lord Jesus is the way. So if I'm looking for a job opportunity, I'm looking for marriage, I'm looking for anything that will transform my life, I have to get the way. And that's Jesus. Whilst he's inside of me, he will show me the way.
Mm-hmm.
That's the difference here.
So all Christians exhibit some kind of life that relates with Christ.
That's the title they have on themselves, Christian. Christ-like people. They do things like Christ. That's but the name.
The churchgoers always have a certain blinded motive.
Yeah.
To get something.
Yeah.
Okay.
They are always after things.
Things, material things.
But like God does not give things.
Yeah. As God we said the other time.
Yeah. He doesn't give things. So they come with a wrong motive. Mm. That's why they will come, they will pray and sweat, but nothing happens. They are wrongly busy with things. But whereas a Christian who has the Spirit of God in him, stand 5 minutes, Father, I thank you for giving it to me. And just walk away. Because I know I've received, therefore I come to him and thank him. Look at Christ when he went to cemetery the other day. Lot of people were in the cemetery buried together with Lazarus. He said, Father, I thank you. After giving thanks to his Father, Lazarus came out. That's it. So Christians don't struggle in prayer, but churchgoers struggle in prayer.
So that is one of the characteristics of
yeah.
a Christian and churchgoer.
That's true.
Yeah. Can you also give another to that effect so that you would distinguish between a Christian, that when you see this lady or you see this gentleman, you see that this is the real Christian,
mm-hmm.
and this is a churchgoer, apart from the first point you raised.
Okay. Yeah. When you deal with a Christian who is angry,
mm-hmm.
he understands the principles of the kingdom.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus said, you can be angry,
yeah.
but do not sin.
Mm-hmm.
Do not let the sun go down on your anger.
Mm-hmm.
It's a kingdom principle.
Yeah.
Why? The King of Kings said, don't be. And as long as I'm a king under this King of Kings, I obey my king.
Yeah.
So if I'm angry with you, I'll come to you. I'm angry with you, but I'll come to you. Why? My King of Kings said, if your brother wrongs you, go to him.
Yeah.
I'll rather go. Churchgoers expect you to come to him.
And even humble them in their hearts.
In their hearts. And if you don't come to him to seek for apology, he will harbor those things for years.
Yeah.
But the principle says, don't let the sun go down on your anger. Not even a day. But churchgoers harbor them for days,
for years,
weeks, months. Anytime they see you, that resentment is within them. And that is not correct.
So viewers, that is a little bit about the characteristics and then the disparity between a Christian and a churchgoer. Eda has said it all. So Eda will continue about his life background.
Yeah.
Okay.
And also, when I came to Europe at the age of 22, 23,
wow.
I was young, so I had fun. I didn't forget God, actually, but my mother was constantly on the phone with me. Do you go to church? Do you read the Bible as you used to do when you were in Ghana? Yes. But Friday evening, I had to be at the disco because it's
amazing.
A youth night. Saturday, R&B.
Amazing.
All black people go to disco. Sunday after party, I have to be there.
And you pay for it?
Of course, entrance. I don't drink alcohol, I don't smoke. So entrance fees are a problem for me.
Yeah.
And when I get in the disco at 10:30, 11, I don't sit down. I make sure I dance from 11 to 3 that the disco closes.
Incredible.
I don't get tired. I don't get paid for. I won't waste my time to go and buy energy drink. I'm energized. That was my lifestyle. And there are so many people out there that my dance attracted them. That led me to fornication and a whole lot of stuff. So, in the world, there's pleasure there, but now I found my pleasure in Christ and out there in the world.
Yeah. Before we come to when you met Christ, I want us to spend a little bit about your life in the world. We'll get to the school you went and what actually happened in the school. You know, when talking about secondary school and then and the likes, the tertiary education, a lot of things goes into it, more especially with the youthful exuberant. All of us want to exhibit some kind of life that are unique. So which school did you attend, and then you give us a brief what actually happened in it? We want to get into viewers, you want to get into Ed's life, so that it will also motivate you, it will serve as an instigational tool to motivate you to stop what you are doing. And then after we come to the lifestyle of Christ, you will know that this is the true life you will lead, and then it will help you also grow your Christian life. So let's get to your second cycle activities and then operations.
Yes, okay. Edda, thank you. Yeah. I went to Chinebo Akodia Secondary School in Kumau. TK, in Kumau. Wow. And I was very young. I started Form 1 1987.
Wow.
At the age of 14. And I was a kid.
Very young.
I was a kid. And I couldn't see much because I was at that age. I didn't know my left and my right. And I've spent some time to recalculate years back. I couldn't see anything that I did that was bad, actually. I was always closer to my mom, and she really directed me in such a way that I don't become wayward. But when I went to prison, maybe at the point in time when we get there.
In Ghana or here?
Here in Europe. When I went to prison, I saw the lifestyle of my inmates there, and I missed it. Wow, I should have done this when I was before 17, 18 years, but I couldn't get the time to do that. Now in my 30s in prison, I begin to reminisce all the things that I'm supposed to have done. So back to secondary school, whilst those boys were smoking weed and cigarette and alcohol, going to the town to chase girls, I never did any of those. My bad habits started when I was in Europe here.
Okay.
In my late 20s, yeah.
So in Europe, you came by yourself or somebody brought you here?
My aunt brought me here.
Okay. Yeah. So you were staying with your aunt?
No, she was actually in Germany and we were in Holland. But we lived together with my cousins. So after 2 years, I thought, nah, my mother didn't raise me up that way to always be dependent on people.
Okay.
So I quit that house. I went to rent a student's room. And I lived there with the whites in a white student room. So I pick up earlier on my own way up.
So way back in Ghana, where you related to your mom so much that you always be with her, and then when you came to Europe and that connection wasn't there, how was it like?
You know, those days there was nothing like a phone. I'm talking about the early 90s, 93, 94, 95. There was things like phone, so she normally would record her voice on a cassette tape, send it to me, I play. So anytime I'm on bicycle or my motorcycle, I listen to her voice all the time. The Bible quotations, the preachings she sent to me, the prayer books and those stuff. She meant that I be on guard, on course. So even though I'll bypass left and right, but I still come back to the course. That's why I always like this quotation so much. The Bible says in Proverbs that teach up a child the way he should go. That when he goes, he'll never depart from it. And it's correct.
Yeah.
My mother set me on that path. I thought she was, being so harsh to me. But when I was in prison, that's where I realized what she was doing was the correct thing to do. And that's what I'm doing for my kids now. Yeah.
Okay. So when you came to Europe and the lifestyle in Ghana was different because your mom was there to guide you, correct you, and all that. And when it came to AA Europe. What actually changed?
What changed was the weather is part of it. Because mm-hmm. here, if it's cold, you are indoors. Yeah. But back then, in the home, it's sunny always. And you have places to go, you have friends to see, you have friends to visit. And money was also another factor. Back home, I couldn't get the money to travel from a sea of water to another place. But here, I get in my own car, drive anywhere I want. So here, the freedom is much here than back home. And there's no restrictions here. Back home, if I get out 5:30, I must be home. Before I leave, he said, look at the kitchen before you go. Mm-hmm. He pointed me the empty pots. Now, go. And our eating time was 5:36. So I know for sure if I'm not home by then, I have to sleep without food. And that was one of the ways he uses to restrict us. And it worked perfect. But here, I buy my own food. I do everything on my own as a free man. But so the chance of spoiling here and going wayward is higher. Nobody controls you. Do whatever you want. Can you imagine? I live in Tilburg, about 1.5 hours from Amsterdam. Yeah. I had friends over there. In the evening, 5:30, when I come from work, 5:30 Friday, shower down, get my car, and I'm there. Chill out the whole weekend before I come back home. But there in Ghana, I couldn't do those things. So here, the chance of being worldly and wayward is higher.
It's very high.
So if God helps you to pull you to Him here in Europe, then He has saved you twice.
Yeah. Yeah. Cherished viewers, that means that Elder really enjoyed himself because of the discos and then the R&Bs and
soul,
all that.
Women,
yeah,
stuff.
Yeah. Dancing around yeah. with guys and ladies and all that. It's all good. Our vision and mission is that we are bringing this on the table so that when you are in the same lifestyle, by what we're doing, we'll transform and alert you that there is a life that is more than what you think you are in now. So, Elder, I want us to move to now. You've lived a life that is horrible. Let's come back to how you met your wife.
Okay.
How you met your wife?
My current wife.
Yeah.
Okay. I met my current wife when I came back from prison. Because the circumstances that led me in there was terrible. So it brought a lot of dispute between me and my ex-wife, which I would say 90% I am guilty of it. I know one day she will have the chance to watch me in this interview, but I give her the credit. And I didn't understand her. It was later that when things have finished falling apart, that was too late. That's where I realized what she was saying was correct. So I met my current wife when my sister Gifty brought me to I visited her here in Belgium, and I met my current wife in her place. And you know, men, we move by attraction.
Attraction, yeah.
So she attracted me one way or the other. So we exchanged numbers. I called for months. She never returned my call. Okay, so finally we met. And we spoke for a while, and meanwhile she too had divorced that time. So I thought, then why not? I'm coming from one, you are coming from one. Let's hook up together.
Yeah.
So we met, and that was it.
Wow, that is amazing.
Yeah,
that is amazing meeting. Before you continue, what actually drove you into prison? What triggered that?
Yeah, prison. Happened? You know, the Bible says if you gain all this world and you lose your soul, what profit does it have?
Yeah.
You retain nothing. Friends, influence. I like money.
Yeah.
Everybody likes it.
Everybody's battling for it.
Yeah, and my favorite car is Mercedes.
Yeah.
And God's grace, I had two.
Wow.
So I had to maintain it. Uh-huh. And I had a very big African shop in Tilburg with 7 employees.
Wow.
A very expensive place where the shop was. So when things were in its ascendancy in a good point, I couldn't feel it.
Yeah.
But I would say when 25-30% of the people who come to the shop begin to migrate to UK, the sales begin to decline.
Decline, yeah.
And you must continue paying your workers.
Oh, yeah.
You must continue paying the rent, and everything. Nothing is getting less. And where my house, my bought house, was a very expensive area, so also the mortgage need to be paid. So I had to get extra things done. I had a Mercedes van that I transport people's stuff from one point to the other, and I charge them.
Yeah.
So a friend introduced me to drugs, and he said, if you can do this, one trip can solve the problem. Wow. I said, why not?
And give it a try.
I give it a try. From Ghana to Amsterdam, I've been doing it. From Ghana to South Africa, I've been doing it.
Wow.
From Amsterdam to UK, I've been doing it. So it was sweet. The money was okay. I began to invest in certain things, and things began to get better. So one fateful day, I was going to UK with some few drugs with me. Not even much, just 2 kilos. Not much.
Wow.
And in the port of Dover, I was arrested. And I packaged the things myself in a furniture. And in fact, the way the package is, it takes a genius to discover that there's drugs hidden in a piece of furniture there in the car. So they brought everything out, scanned left and right. They couldn't find it. I was sitting there watching them. And I said in my mind, if God permits you to catch me, then it's by his will.
Wow. That was the word you said?
That's the word I tell to myself when I was waiting there. So they put the furniture in its edge in the scanner. We couldn't fit. They turned it upside down. They couldn't see it. One woman came from nowhere and said, break the standing pieces and put it back in again. When they broke it, they saw a thin line. They said, I have a hint.
Wow.
It's come from the other side. And that thin line, so they have 2 lines now. They need 4 lines to establish
it.
Something inside there. And when you put the furniture on its height, it doesn't fit the machine. So they have to remove the under part of the machine and scan the machine on top of the piece of furniture, because I constructed my own center table. Fit everything into it, because no way you can catch me.
Yeah.
I had a technical school background, so I know how to fix my furniture. So I did everything myself. And then lo and behold, it took them hours.
Wow.
And the woman said, you are very smart, but today you are under arrest. I said, you have to prove me. And still I was insisting my innocence until they dismantled the table and found the drugs in the table. And they said, you are under arrest. I said, thank God. And they look at each other's face. They handcuffed me, and that was it.
So at that point in time, and when they said you've been caught, and then you've been arrested for that offense, and what actually went through your mind? What was going through your mind?
I was happy.
Why?
A kind of joy filled me, and up to date, I don't know why. Because if I was not arrested by then, I would have been dead by now. Because one trip before then, this one, I was from Ghana going to South Africa with drugs here in my stomach.
Wow.
And I collapsed in the plane. Now, before then, I had severe pain in my stomach. So I thought one of the cocaine pebbles have burst. So I rushed to the toilet, nothing came. On my way back, I collapsed. And then when I realized, they put me back again with ice block on my chair and so everything. So when I landed in South Africa, I went to ease myself and dispatch it. So in the hotel, I prayed to God, I won't do this business again. Help me to stop it. Because it was addictive. Money comes in.
Yeah.
Within a year to 3 years, I built 3 houses.
Incredible.
Yeah, it was okay. It was okay, and cars and stuff. But I don't count them. I count all these things but lost to Christ.
Yeah.
And then when I said that prayer, I felt the Holy Spirit saying to me, keep your word, and I'll keep my word for you.
Wow.
And I remember this prayer about 4-5 years earlier. I went with my mother to a prayer camp. We were praying, and the pastor touched my head and showed her and said, keep God's word, and he'll keep his word for you.
Wow.
Exactly 5 years in that same month, that thought came again. I decided not to do it anymore. So when I came back to Holland, things were normal. I was running my normal business. So when things began to decline, I picked it up again, and I heard a voice again. And on my way, I was arrested. So when they say you were in arrest, I said, thank God. I was happy it happened that way. Because if it didn't have happened, that by now, oh, my funeral had been done and nobody would even remember me. And it was then the prison where I had an encounter with God. That transformed me totally from who I was to today.
Yeah.
Total transformation.
You come to the prison yard and then the events that actually took. But well, those friends that introduced you into that enterprise, and then your auntie and your mom, what actually happened when, first of all, your friend heard that you've been caught?
Mm-hmm.
What happened? Yeah, and then your auntie here, because she brought you here.
Yeah.
So what actually happened?
My mother really, when I was arrested, I pick up the phone at the police station. I like to make two phone calls. I call my wife then, and I call my mom that it's better I tell you now.
Yeah.
You know, Europe, we have problem with paper conditions and stuff, so it's normal to go to prison. Europe prison is like a hotel, mom. So if you hear I'm in prison, don't worry at all. Because before then, I was a prison officer.
In Ghana?
Here. In Holland, I was a prison officer. I used to close the door up.
Wow.
I used to do everything. I mean, I went higher to court level, to police level and stuff. So I was a prison officer myself. And my mother said, but you're a prison officer? I said, yes, but now I'm behind the bars. Because my papers are not in order. That's a lie I told my mom. So I don't want anybody to scare you that I'm in prison. When you hear it, tell them you know it.
Yeah.
So when they release me, my papers will be in order. And my mother was okay with that. But only my aunt, who had been living here for a long time, I couldn't fool her.
Wow.
So I went straight and told her, mom, I've been arrested for drug trafficking. And she was disappointed in me, really.
Yeah.
So you have a bright future.
So
all those, even older than you, those below you, they all look up to you. A very example in the family. You are different from everyone in the family. Why did you bring yourself in distance? She was disappointed in me, really. And she had every right to be.
Yeah, of course.
And
of course.
When I hung the phone up, that's where pain started. I said, what have I got myself into?
Oh.
But I know it was God's will that He set me apart for that moment.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, and your wife? What happened to her?
In fact, she was distraught. She was really, really kaput.
Was she aware of what actually was going on in your life?
Yes, and she warned me several times.
Okay.
Like I said earlier on, she warned me several
but
times.
But you were adamant to it.
Yeah, I said, but you, anything you touch become a blessing. Why are you mixing things with God's blessing? She knows that anything I touch, give everybody 100 euro to trade, give me 10. I'll shoot up.
You increase up.
That's me. That's how God made me. And one prophetess that I named my last daughter after her, she said, God has made you like a cassava stick.
Yeah.
Wherever you put cassava stick, it will sprout. And that's me. Put me everywhere. So if you check my profile picture of my
WhatsApp,
you see how the pawpaw tree shoot out of the wall.
Yeah.
That's me. Put me everywhere and I'll sprout. So my ex-wife said, should you be doing this? I've warned you. When you came to prison to visit me, I said, it's enough. I've heard enough. It's all right. Thank you. Now, I'm sorry. It has happened.
Yeah.
But one thing that today, and today I always say, God wanted it to happen. And I thank
God. As an example.
Yeah. And I thank God it happened. If it had not happened, the fun would have killed me. They happen, you know, when you have money controls you.
Of
you
course.
Don't control the money.
Of course.
I went to places that I have never been in my normal senses. I wouldn't be there.
Yeah.
I bought things that I wouldn't have bought. Why would I have to travel from here to Switzerland to buy a piece of watch? And
wow.
For what? What would the watch do? But I did it.
So the money was controlling?
Yes.
The sphere of your life?
Yeah. I helped those who needed. I gave. But that was not God's plan for me.
Yeah.
That was, now that I don't do those things, I can say I am richer than those times.
Of course.
And imagine you are carrying a drag of 10 kilos cocaine in your hand and police is meeting you with a dog. How would you feel?
Mm-hmm.
Your heart will jump up. Your BP will double.
Yeah.
And it will shorten. Even if the police does not catch you, that feeling at that moment, somebody can collapse.
Yeah.
So if I pass the police, and whether that doesn't mean I'm strong, I'm dead already.
Of course.
Those things were shortening my lifespan gradually, but I didn't see it. And when I went to prison, I had time to sit down and make a reflection of it. Say, wow. Wow. So I hate the Bible. I started hitting the Bible straight. I read from cover to cover. Mm-hmm. I read. And any point, I see Jesus on every book, every page, every chapter. I saw Jesus all and all and all and all throughout. And one thing, they smuggle mobile phones inside prison. So I had my mobile phone in prison. Yeah. I had pastor friends. When I text them motivational message, yeah. Not pray for me. No. They didn't want anybody to pray for me. I pray for them instead. And the most of them, they get their message to preach from what I sent to them.
Like Paul.
Yeah. And most of them didn't believe me. I was in prison. I said, yeah, I'm here. Most of them, how can you test me? I said, don't worry. But this is what God says I should tell you. And it's true. One of them is in South Africa. I know he'll by all means watch me. He loved me so much, he named his son even after me. And all the things I told him when I was there, exactly what is going on.
So, when you were arrested, and your friends, now where are they? Are they still in it or they are still?
I told them to quit.
Yeah, and by the grace, I think.
Yes. Three Nigerians, I don't know where they are, whereabouts, but two Ghanaians and one Togolese, they have all stopped. I told them to stop. It's because you don't realize the harm you do to people on the street. Yeah. If you can render somebody's mother drug addict until the government snatch his or her child from him, then you, the carrier, you have caused a great havoc. Now, when you are busy, you don't think that side.
Yeah.
But when you are arrested and you begin to think about the life that drug do to people on the street, that you feel sorry for yourself and for them.
Yeah.
So they all stopped.
It's so sad. And then the situation you went through wasn't...
I lost everything. I lost everything. My house, my shop, employees, my family. I lost a big time. I lost almost everything. The only thing I had left was my life that I breathed. So when I came, even a house, I began everything from my good friend's living room. I slept in the living room.
Cherished viewers, that is so sad.
It's not sad. It's a happy moment.
It's a happy moment, yes. But it's the situation is sad.
Yeah.
But it has challenged his life, and now he is a born-again Christian. Cherished viewers, if you are going through same situation, never mind. Don't be bothered. We have somebody who can help you, who can deliver you from all these setup. Until we are through with this, I believe that your life will definitely change for a better. That is Kingdom Life Channel. We are bringing this lifestyle background from our dear elder to your table so that it will also motivate you and stop whatever lifestyle you are living in Europe, wherever you find yourself. Elder, so I presumably also believe that triggered the an attempt of your wife to divorce you or what? I don't know.
Yes, more or less. You know, when you are with your wife and she's doing one thing or the other you don't like, you tell, stop, she doesn't stop, yeah. And she gets herself in a mess, you get fed up. But that's not the thing. My stubbornness is not the reason, by women. Not being unfaithful in my previous marriage caused these things. And she had every right to. My sister would do the same, my mother would do the same, so why not her? So it's not the trafficking stuff by women.
Wow. Yeah.
You know, if you are rich, you choose what you want. It's like a rich man in a restaurant, you choose what you like to eat.
You always extend your hand to whatever.
Yeah, whatever touches it. That is why infidelity caused it.
Yeah, of course. So, in a prison, what actually happened?
I don't know what to say. I went to a prison for 2 years and 3 months.
Wow.
and I was sentenced to 8.5 years in prison. And the day that I was sentenced, my pastor friend called me from Ghana and said, you have 1 year more to go.
Yeah.
They will leave you, and that day, you beg them to keep you.
Wow.
I said, it's a pastor, Ransford, that is his name.
Ransford Obi.
Ransford, yeah, he's in Kumasi.
Yeah. And then, C is a CCC of...
No,
okay.
He has his own small private church going on. So, Pastor, what did you say? He said, they will leave you,
mm-hmm.
and you beg them to keep you.
Wow.
And he just laughed. I said, God kept you there for schooling.
For a purpose.
The schooling will complete exactly a year from today.
Mm-hmm.
I said, okay, if God has said it, I will not ask any questions. I accepted it.
Yeah.
And then I asked for a repatriation to be transferred to Holland because I'm a Dutch citizen.
Okay.
And they prolonged the procedure because they know when I get here, they will leave me alone. So to cut a long story short, the reason how I came back, when I reached Schiphol, they told me, is that your bag? Yeah, come and sign here. I signed. They said, go home.
That was it.
I looked back. I thought they were talking to somebody behind me. They said, go home. You can go. I said, go away. He said, Hana House in Dutch. And I stood there. He said, you've been free. You are free. Go.
Wow.
So I just bowed down my head with a sigh of relief. I said, Mevrouw, they sentenced me 8.5 years. And you say I should go home. He said, yeah.
But was it in a law court or what? Was it legal procedures or?
The legal procedures took a year and I went to 14 times court.
Wow.
14 times to court within a year.
It's a lawyer.
14 times, yeah. 14 times. And every time I sit down to calculate what that symbolically means, 7 is complete.
Mm-hmm.
Double complete.
Mm-hmm.
God has completed his work in me. Go home.
Wow.
While everybody go to court, you say your name, they adjourn it, man's one third time they sentence you. I went 14 times. And it has never happened according to the office of that man who was my
barrister.
My barrister. He said, he has a warum. Why? Every time I go, date of birth, your last name, take him away.
Oh.
I'll trap the whole of England. There's no prison I've not been in it. Everywhere I've been in it. For 3 days, 1 week, 3 days, 1 week, 1 month, 2 days.
Oh.
It was tough.
You were tasting all the prisons.
Cockroaches and it helped also to view England is a very beautiful country,
yeah,
really.
Course, yeah.
The hills and stuff. But sometimes when other inmates in the car are struggling and banging the doors, Holy Spirit will tell me, look at the window. I just look at the window and see the beautiful landscape. The green hills, the way the sky is, the horizon, I begin to admire God's handiworks. You see where mine was coming from?
Yeah.
So God is so wondering, how could God make this? I don't see this beauty from where I'm coming from. Now I'm admiring nature. I see the birds swinging in the skies. I see the sun going down the hills. Wow, what an awesome God. Mm-hmm. And the more I admire him in praises and worship within me, by the time I realized we are inside the prison, I don't even remember where the car went, how we went through the journey, how long it took. I didn't know.
Wow.
And that thing has helped me now not to look at my present circumstances, but even to look outside.
Mm-hmm.
Look outside. Just look outside. When I'm going to my work and it's traffic jam, people are blowing their horns and cursing, I just step out and begin to admire nature. I begin to see God's handiworks, how perfect it is, the reflection of this God we don't see in his creation.
Mm-hmm.
It made the time very short.
Wow.
I begin to understand things. Those are the teachings I went through that nobody put a blackboard there to teach me. But in the midst of those things, God revealed himself to me in another way. But I don't say nobody should go to prison and learn my way.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone has his own way that God teaches him.
Because, everybody has... his or her cross, and you have to carry it.
Yeah.
And just as David also went through those terrifying moments, and then later God upgraded him.
Yeah.
So when the announcement came that, go, you've been released,
mm-hmm.
what thought came in your mind that now, this time around, when I'm out from here, I'm going to live what life or this type of life. So what actually came your mind?
When I was released that evening, I stood in the floors of Schiphol and knelt down and raised my hands and thanked God. People thought I was crazy. They were looking at me. And when I was in the train that evening, as if Satan is sitting at the chair opposite to me, and he just told me into my face, you go back to where you came from because you have no wife, you have no house, you have no money. They will insult you, they will humiliate you. You go back. The only way to get it done is through the same procedure that gets you in. It's like, Edda, as me and you sitting here and you talking to my face, I just feel the presence, you know, and I say, I rebuke you in the name, of, Jesus. I'm not going back. My lesson has been done. Whatever brought me there was a mistake. And as long as I'm in him, I'm a new creation. I am in him justified. He is in me glorified. So, uprooted. I get that courage to say those things out of my mouth. People in the train were looking at me as if I'm crazy, but it's like I'm talking to him back. And I had pimples all over my skin. I felt very cold. And 10 minutes after the train, I arrived to my destination. I only stayed at my brother's house. When I came home, from that time up to now, I've never seen those stuff before.
So it doesn't matter whether you're Christian or not, Satan can still trumpet a sound in your ears.
Satan trumpets only to truly Christians who have God's spirit within them, to test them and
just
to know
as
them.
He did to Jesus Christ.
Those who come to church go, he doesn't bother themselves with them.
He doesn't waste his time.
Because you are part of him, so why?
So, who changed you?
God changed
me. Who said a message to your heart, message to your mind, that it's high time you give your life to Christ?
Christ himself.
Wow.
His spirit. He did it. Not human being. Like I began earlier, my mother did her best, as every mom or dad will grow up her kid, but it takes God to do it. So, if you have the foundation there, building on top is not difficult. So whilst I had the basics, the Holy Spirit just had to push me back to the root again. That's all. So it was God who changed me, not human. Not the many advices and the memories and of my ex-wife could do it. It's God who changed me. And one thing that pains me now is she's not now here to live the life that I live now. That's what pains me sometimes.
Yeah, I wanted to ask you this question. But I'll ask her, when you were released, did you call your wife then?
Yeah, I called her. And even when I came home, because anger is anger. When it's in you, you can't let go at once. And she wouldn't come. She was angry. I know, I understand.
Yeah.
I gave her 100% the right that you have every right to be angry. Even you can slap me as hard as you want. But it takes two to tango. If I'm angry, you are angry. You can't solve it. See, and one thing is, if you know, goat or sheep, they like eating leaves. So if you lock up a goat or sheep in the pen for 3-4 days, you don't feed it. The moment you open the door, what would you think the sheep would do? It will run back to leaves to eat. So I thought, I've been locked up for 2 years, I've never seen a woman before, and I want you to kind of when I come, women, where are you? So I began after the women. Didn't we learn a lesson? I said, yeah, but if you don't come, I'm going. So I thought I could wait, not knowing it was another breaking point again.
Wow. So sad. But as he said, it was a happy moment and it was educational.
Yeah.
And I think that's how it's supposed to be.
Yeah.
He passed through those things as a training ground.
Yeah.
To have an orientation, and now his life has been oriented to a standard or point where his life is now grounded in the world. So the disparity between when we were in the world and now, can you share with us the life you led and now the life of Christ?
Now the life I live for Christ. Because I cannot do anything on my own except him who does it through me. In him I live, in him I have my being. He controls my thoughts. And any time any carnal thought comes into me, he tells me to abort it, and I have to let his will prevail. No, it's, I cannot finish one sentence without quoting. I cannot finish one sentence without speaking the Spirit. So I can see now that I'm changed.
You're changed.
Yeah, the way I see things, I don't see them like how I used to. Yeah. Situations may come, I just see it as some minute comma in a sentence. It's not a full stop.
Yeah.
And every day I'm motivated by the Spirit that I can do more than what I have done before. And this quotation has always been ringing a bell in my mind, Ephesians 3:16. Now unto him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly more than I can but think or imagine. These two things, and there's an end there, according to the power that's at work in me. Because I know there's a power at work in me. So if I can think or imagine, he will do it. And these things is driving me on.
Yeah.
And the current business I have, 80% of my clients are women. And in the car, I am sitting beside a woman. Never had it occurred to me to go and date a client. But back then, when I used to run the African shop, oh, come on.
Wow.
So it's a big difference.
Yeah.
And the Holy Spirit will just speak to you.
Yeah.
Speak to me. And the desire is no more there.
Yeah.
You don't have the desire to do those things anymore.
Because the Spirit of God always prompts you not to.
Yeah.
So you committed yourself to the things of the evil one or the ways of the world.
Mm-hmm.
You sacrificed everything.
Yeah.
So now, I want us to deal with this commitment.
Mm-hmm.
Many people are committed to sin. Many people are committed to eat a certain fruit from the devil. Many people are committed to act on to violate the principles of God. Many people are doing things. Many people, even in the Christian family, they are still wearing the old clothes, yet they are in the Christian faith. As today's Christian, how can we commit? And before we go, what is commitment? Because we have commitment in the world. Commitment is a general perspective.
Okay.
I am basing on what you went through.
Yeah.
You committed to sell out cocaine and then crack and then weed and all that.
Yeah.
Can we replicate that one in our dispensation as Christian?
Yes.
Yeah.
We can in so many ways. And commitment goes hand in hand with dedication.
Yeah.
Anything that you love so much, you dedicate your time, your effort, your skills to it, to make it a success. So there is where we can see how committed you are to one thing or the other. Now, like I said, I wanted to make sure I keep my Mercedes running. My heart was dedicated to my Benz, that nothing will stop me from driving my Benz. So if I don't have money, I must find money to refuel my car. I'm committed to doing any business that will bring me money to make sure I am still on top. I'm so much committed that I don't want to fall. Now, when I came to Christ, I'm so much committed to his word. God, that's the only way I know God. That's the only way I know Christ. Many people say they know God, but they don't know Christ.
Yeah.
If you don't know Jesus, you don't know God. So, if I commit my time, there are 24 hours in a day, 8 hours to sleep, 8 hours to work, 8 hours for your daily chores. These last 8 hours, I must divide it with him. I must share it. In every way I am, I must make sure that my commitment to the word supersedes my interest even to it. And that has kept me forward. Because in that commitment into it, it will spring out in so many branches where giving becomes part of your life, where holiness becomes part of your life, where righteousness becomes part of your life. Many Christians don't do this, they are not committed because of the word religion. Religion is back to bondage. Religion is a practice, it's a make-believe. What am I saying all these things? If you are committed to your word and to your God, you know how to go about things. Why am I coming from? Now, somebody might say, I go to the church, I read my Bible. Yes, we all do. But how committed are you? When situation arises, how do you deal with it? Do you allow what you live, what you read, to live by it? And they all go with the slogan, no one is perfect, no one is righteous. They want, you don't know who you are.
Yeah.
If you are committed to the God you serve, you are committed to His word, you know that you are righteous and you are holy and you are pure.
Upright, yeah.
Yes. Take water, for instance. Water is shapeless and formless. Mm-hmm. The moment water gets into a kind of bottle, it takes the shape of the bottle.
Yeah.
When the bottle is red and you put clear water in it, you stand and say, you might think the water is red. Mm-hmm. It's taking the shape of the bottle. So if Christ lives in you, you become like Him. So you can't tell me you were a Christian, Christ lives in you, and you say, I'm not righteous. Then there's something wrong with you. Then you are not committed enough. If you are deeply committed and your heart is dedicated to His word, you become like Him. But the Bible says in 1 John, just as He is, so are we in this world.
Because God has made us righteous, that's perfect, it. Upright, through
Christ,
His Son, Jesus Christ.
That's true.
Wow. Yeah. So when we are committed to Jesus Christ, it must be absolute.
Yeah, you know, some people have God's spirit.
Yeah.
That's why they say. But God's spirit doesn't have them. Mm-hmm. You know the difference here? If I drink a cup of water, what happens to the water? It gets into me.
Yeah.
You don't see it. But when I jump inside the pool, what happens? I'm covered from my head to my toe, from my head to my toe, with water, soaked. That is why committed to Christ means. Don't just take the spirit in, because nobody sees it. But let the spirit take you. When the spirit overshadows you, it fills you from head to your toe. Nobody, have you ever seen somebody coming out of a pool and it's wet? And someone will ask, what happened to you? You see, I'm wet.
Yeah.
And you ask, what happened to me? Drowning by the river doesn't, you don't have to beg the water to wet you. By wetness, you yourself, you know that you are in the water. That's how it is. So if you are committed and deeply committed, the Holy Spirit will take over you. Your speech, your sign, your walking, your dressing, everything about you takes shape of the water that has wet you. That's how it is.
So our Master Jesus that we are looking up to, relying on, depending on, we must also exhibit His kind of examples or legacy He led. For instance, He committed Himself so that when you become a Christian, you must commit also yourself to it in giving.
Yeah.
Can you throw more light on giving?
Yeah, the more I talk about giving, people are scared. Because everybody talks about giving.
Yeah.
What about the receiving?
Yep.
We don't talk about the receiving. Most people don't talk about the receiving.
Yeah.
But without receiving, giving is not complete.
Yeah.
Understand? Uh-huh. Most people think, if I come to church, for instance, and I give a tithe or I give an offering, the pastor is going to chop. Because they don't know the receiving end.
Mm-hmm.
So the giving becomes difficult.
It's good for them.
So for you or for any Christians to learn how to give, you must take the receiving end. For example, I came to your house, I presented to you a box, nicely wrapped. I gave it to you and I left. What a beautiful box. Elder, thank you. You place it there and it's in the table. The box is not a gift.
Yep.
The wrappings is not a gift. The bow tie on top of it is not a gift. Even when you are unwrapped, you open the box, that gift is inside another container.
Yeah.
That one is not even a gift yet. Until you go deeper to see the gift itself.
Content.
The content. So the content is not even the gift until it is used.
You use it.
Then it becomes a gift. We all have this famous quotation, for God so loved the world that He gave His Son, gave His only begotten Son, that whoever believeth in Him should not perish. They will put a full stop there.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody has Jesus. Jesus was a gift from God. But what is inside Him? The Christ, we don't want to have it. We come to church, how many times do we say in Jesus' name? Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. We sing Jesus, everything Jesus. What about the Christ? What about the content? And if you are not committed to Jesus, you can never find the Christ.
Yeah, you are driving my mind to this. So what is actually, if I think my viewers will also ask this question. Mm-hmm. What is in Christ that we need to emulate and embrace? What is actually in Christ?
What is in Christ is God.
It's God. Yeah, I know, but because he exhibited some characters, mm-hmm. that he said we need to embrace and then imbibe in it. Yeah. So there's some behaviors in Christ.
Yes.
That as Christian, we need to embrace or emulate.
Yeah, those things are in Galatians chapter 5. You see, Christ is, Jesus is a God-sent man. Because Jesus is a man.
He's a man, yeah.
And what made him legal here on earth is his body.
Yeah.
So Jesus Christ is God in the flesh.
Yeah.
Now, for you to be a follower of someone and you don't do like him, it doesn't qualify you to be.
Yeah.
Christ is love.
Yeah.
He is patient. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Those qualities that Galatians chapter 5 listed.
Verse 22.
Yes. You need to get all those things in you. And if I'm not mistaken, I think there are 9 of them. Why are they 9? God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. The fruit of the Spirit I'm talking about here.
Uh-huh.
Now, Holy Spirit will give you 3. The Father will give you 3. He says the Son will give you 3. None of them will give you 2 and say, go and collect 4 from another one. So if you have 8, God gave you 3. Holy Spirit gave you 3. Did Jesus give you 2? No, it must be complete. So the more committed you are to him, these 9 things will be unfold in your life. And then you know that you begin to live like the one who called you.
Because if we read the Galatians 5:22, it said, but the fruit of the Spirit.
Yes.
He didn't say fruits.
The fruit.
The fruit.
Yeah.
Of the Spirit. So is Jesus the fruit producing
those
branches, those leaves, those fruit? So first of all, one character of Jesus we all need to exhibit is love.
Yeah.
Can you throw more light on that?
Yeah, love is what people think. Life is deep.
Yeah, it's deep.
God is love.
God is love.
Love is God. The love we are talking about is a love that is unconditional. It's not like when you give me a pencil, I'll give you an eraser back. If you don't, I don't.
It's not optional.
Mm-hmm. But God's love is unconditional. Even while we are still yet sinners, he came to die for you. It's not about what you have done. So if you want to exhibit that kind of Christ love to a brother, don't wait for him to do 1 or 2 before you do what you have to do. Do it anyway. What do you have to lose? Love. But Christians nowadays, that's what we are doing. We don't do that. We don't do agape. God's love is agape. That's what we're supposed to exhibit. What me and you will have is filial, brother, love. What you and a friend have is different. What you and your spouse have is different.
Yeah.
But the love that God wants us to exhibit is the agape love. Unconditionally. No matter what, don't wait for me to be sick before you come to visit me. Don't wait for me to absent my church for a week before you come and call me, where are you? Whether I come to church or don't come to church, call me and find out how my kids are doing. Do we do that? It's unconditional. So if you begin to go through to the meaning of that agape love, we have totally deviated from our purpose. We don't love these days. We are waiting until end of the year. Love feast before you buy me a gift. Keep it to yourself. I don't need it. Waiting for my birthday before you buy me a gift. Forget it. What about if my birthday doesn't come? So when you wake up in the morning, do you pray for me? When you are making intercession prayer for others, do you mention my name in your prayer? No, you are waiting until you hear that I have a problem before you begin to pray for me. That's not love.
So you don't wait for something to happen to somebody before you show.
Yeah, why don't you pray to prevent that thing shouldn't happen?
Yeah.
I'm on the way. I spend more time on the road than in the house. Have you ever prayed that God protect me through the traffic? You never do it. But when my car got accident, you heard, oh, Elder, we are waiting, praying for me. What? It's too late.
It's too late.
You could have prayed before to prevent it.
So it means that what we're saying, this thing, love, I presume we want to believe that it is not associating to today's Christian folks?
Some say they do. I cannot generalize it. Yeah. But I, for one, I don't do. I have to be honest with you. Jesus said, if you love only those who love you, what is the point?
What is the point?
After all, I love you, I love you back. What about those you don't know? So those who are not in the same church with me, those I see on the street, I'm more connected to them than those here.
Yeah.
Why? At least them, they are in darkness. In my business now, I have more Muslims than Christians. If you see how I threw light about God, Jesus Christ to them, you'll be surprised. Mm-hmm. I will not come and preach Jesus to you. Yeah. You don't need him. You have him already. What about those who don't have him? The things I post every morning on my WhatsApps, more than 700 messages every morning to unbelievers, they receive it. Nobody has even insulted me back. But the ones he appreciates, amen, thank you. The Muslim, you are praying for Muslim in the name of Jesus, they say, amen, thank you. Oh, one day, it will hit him. But a fellow Christian will receive the same message, even, God bless you, will never say it. And I'm not expecting it. I'm doing it because I'm doing it. So when it comes to love, Christians have failed.
More or less, it's, as you said, love can be also linked up to giving, because it's an act of worship. When you love somebody, it means you've given something to the person. And then 2 Corinthians 16:2 says it's an act. Of worship. Yeah. So this love, mm-hmm. this agape love, that how can we embrace and act on it? Because for once, I can say that it is not in today's church.
Okay.
We say that it is, but on the real ground, I don't think it's. Yeah.
The point is, you can't give what you don't have.
Yeah.
If you say love and you don't understand it, you don't even know what it is, you can't give and you can't pray. You can't live by it. I nearly used the word practice, but Christians shouldn't practice love. You should live love. Live love means every day it should be part of you. It's not necessarily giving something to somebody, but do think about someone. You care. Oh, at home, free and the baby, how are they doing? Let me call them to find out how they are. Okay, pastor and the wife, the late comer who came to church last Sunday, where does he live? How does he even come to church? Does he even have money for tram? Somebody who is not expecting you, do you check on them?
Yeah.
We don't do that. We associate only with those who associate themselves with us. The rest can stick. And that is not love.
So we then love is more than what we think it is, because we've taken love as giving material things. But it's more than that, per what we are saying.
Yeah, love is not just giving.
Yep.
Love goes beyond that.
It's good reason.
You can love me without giving me anything.
Yeah.
But we always refer this one, for God so loved the way that he gave. The love was there before the giving came.
Yeah.
You understand? And if I don't love you, I can love you and pray for you. I've not given you anything. But I've given you indirectly a longevity of life. Yeah. I ask God to prolong your days. You understand?
Yeah.
But the love must be there.
Yeah.
If the love is there and you heard someone talking bad about me, you defend me. I will not even hear about it. Your defense has proven your love by yourself. Don't give me anything. Yeah.
Cherished viewers, that is awesome. And that is critical. Elder has given his lifestyle and background. Now we are dealing with the legacies of Christ. One of it is love. When this is in us, then we are like Jesus Christ. When it is not in us, then we are practicing our own thing. This is where we will draw the curtains. We will continue because it's an interesting issue that we need to know. Per Galatians 5:22, we realize that it gave some series of characteristics, so we'll continue from there.
Yeah.
I would like Elder to say one shout out to his family. and we draw the curtains to the halt. Elder,
yeah.
Look into the camera and...
Before I do that, there's something I want us to read from the Galatians you quoted.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Galatians chapter 5, verses 22. It says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love.
Love.
Which spirit is he talking about? From the Spirit.
From the Spirit.
Say the Spirit, a definite article.
Article.
From which Spirit? What Spirit? The Spirit of Christ. Good. When it's inside of you, it produces love.
Love.
Joy. And do you know there's a difference between joy and happiness?
Yeah.
Happiness takes place when something happens. Mm-hmm. So happiness comes from happiness. But when joy is in your heart, it's the Spirit that produces it.
Yeah.
Even though I was in prison, but I experienced a joy that I was free. Within myself, I felt that I owe no one. And I was okay. So when I came out, I was very big. Mm-hmm. Not fat, but muscular. The joy of the world.
The Lord.
Everybody asked me, I began to smile and give answers. People thought I would even run away from where I was.
Yeah.
The joy was there. Yeah. Mm-hmm. If it was happiness, it could have been dimmed.
Yeah.
Peace. Mm-hmm. Hey, now I don't have thousands to sleep on. But when I sleep,
you sleep good.
I sleep good. I don't have any Mercedes Benz to think about
sleep.
The insurance.
Peace of Christ.
I sleep. The peace of God that transcends all understanding has been in me.
Yeah.
And again, he made mention of long suffering.
Long-suffering.
You go through things like I went through, but you can't joy.
Yeah.
You can't all joy. Now I live that flashy life anymore. I don't have three girlfriends at the same time. I'm okay.
Okay.
Too much. You see? Yeah. So all those things have become part of me now. Kindness.
Kindness.
I extend my hand to the needy.
All men. Not most some.
Most especially the needy.
Yeah.
Some people, they think they have it all. But they need just a word from me. And then they are, wow, that's what I needed. I didn't give a million, but a word. A word. Holy Spirit make one wise. Second Timothy said, and from a child you have known the Holy Scriptures. The word Holy Scriptures means the hagios graphe. It is not economic books or biology or literature. It is the Scripture. Jesus said in John 5:39, he says, search the Scriptures, search it, search. In it, you think you have salvation, it is they that testify of me. You see that? So when you go through this kind of things, you have at least a word that you can say it to a brother. You have done him kindness. And again, he said, goodness.
Goodness.
Mm. We always mention this goodness when we are sharing the grace. And the goodness shall follow me all days of my life. But do we practice the goodness?
We do not.
We don't, because we don't know even what it is. All the good deeds that God showers on our way, they are all the goodness. And the last one, he say, faithfulness. Faithfulness here is not only to spouses, but your commitments. The things that you say you will do, commit yourself to it and be faithful to your word. If you know, for instance, that your pay is 1,000 euro, and you are faithful to Christ, you give your 100 euro as tithe,
yep.
You are being faithful there. So when the Spirit of Christ comes into you, Elder, nobody will tell you you are exhibiting these qualities. People outside there will know, and that makes you a Christian. So a Christian without these things, it's a question mark.
Yeah, it's a question.
It's a question mark. So, fellow viewers, I've shared with you my lifestyle from prison to praise,
yeah.
From prison to the platform, from a disco goer to a church comer. A disco dancer to a church dancer, to a motivational speaker who advised people in a wrong way. But today, God has made me a Paul. Don't wait until you get to prison before you change. Change now. If there's a calling upon your life, don't hesitate. Pay heed to the Spirit of the Most High God. Whatever He steers you, better follow it. And I can assuredly prophesy to your life that your life will never be the same. I use this opportunity to extend my warming greetings to Mami Akosua Bachua, my own mother. May God bless you for the path that you set for me. Bridges Uswansa, may God bless you. Wherever you are, I know you are listening to me. Thank you for all that you did for me when I was in prison. Thank you for the words you told me, I wish I knew. But today, I thank God for the transformation He had made through you to me. And finally, to Grace, you have made my bedroom stay a successful one. May God bless you all. In Jesus' name I bless you. Amen.
Amen. Viewers, thank you for your time. And until we meet for another episode, keep hope alive. And we also send greetings to my wife, Nana Ayuafojo, my mother and my sisters back home, and all ladies and women and all guys around. May the peace of God be with you. Amen.